So this is some work that we have been doing in the physics of fluids group in the University of Twente. So there's like some other collaborators on the project as well, which were listed on the slide here, which are together with me, Professor Lozem, Professor Fizico, and also Alexander Blas and Xiaozhu from our group. Okay, so this is sort of a motivational slide while we're doing this. So we have, during this meeting, we have already discussed Rayleigh-Benard convection in several aspects. And when we were doing experiments or simulations in Rayleigh-Benard convection, a lot of people actually look at relatively small Rayleigh-Benard containers, with small I mean that the width of the cell is relatively small compared to the height of the cell. So like, as you can see here, the cell is still in absolute size, is actually still very big. But what's relevant here is the aspect ratio that is relatively small in Rayleigh-Benard experiments, meaning that the width, so like how wide the setup is compared to the height of that setup, that that's is relatively small. And the reason for doing this is that both in experiments and simulations, it's then much easier to reach a high Rayleigh number flow. If you have a smaller container, you have a smaller volume that you need to take care of, so it's easier to reach a high Rayleigh number. You need to have a high Rayleigh number in order to reach Rayleigh numbers typical for experimental or natural phenomena. And in addition, it's also very important to reach this sort of ultimate regime that a lot of people are after. The same goes for like a simulation. If you have a smaller horizontal domain to take care of, the simulation is a lot easier to perform, and it is easier to reach a relatively high Rayleigh number than it would be in a much wider domain. However, when we look at some natural phenomena, so like this is a picture of the Earth just as a sort of illustration, we see that actually very large scale structures can form. And Rayleigh-Benard convection is like one of the typical systems that we want to use in order to get more fundamental insight into heat transfer phenomena. Like here in atmospheric flows, we also have like a system in which both turbulence effects are important, but also heat transfer is important for driving the flows in the atmosphere. So we see here that these the scales of these structures here can form actually can be the size of countries, or at least when you're in a small country like the Netherlands, this structure can be the size of the Netherlands. However, when we look at this on a sort of world scale, we can sort of approximate this still by a sort of two-dimensional or at least the curvature of the Earth on like a smaller scale is kind of a secondary effect. So we can sort of approximate that by a more Cartesian box in order to simply see what happens with Rayleigh-Benard convection in large aspect ratios. So at least that's the goal of the study. We want to see what the what kind of flow structures are formed when we are looking at Rayleigh-Benard convection in the ultimate regime. So it seems to work again, but with a nice background glow now. So what we use for this study is this AFID code that we already discussed during the summer school earlier. This AFID code that we developed in our group and that we also discussed earlier in the summer school. So there's basically three parameters that really control the system in this case. So like this would be the Rayleigh number, which is the dimensionless temperature difference. So we have already discussed this a lot. The Prandtl number, which negates the properties of the fluids. And then what we will focus on here is the aspect ratio, but then still in the turbulent regime. So we still have like a very high Rayleigh number, but then for also very, very large aspect ratios. So the Prandtl number will be fixed to 1 in the whole talk. So this means like it's something close to a gas. So like a lot of experiments are performed at like Prandtl 0.7, but here we pick Prandtl 1. And then we vary the aspect ratio. So basically the main question that we want to see in this talk is like how does the aspect ratio, so like how does the geometry of the system, how does that influence the heat transfer in the system indicated by the Nusselt number, and how does it influence the flow properties? And like one global measure of this would be the Reynolds number, but it can also influence the flow structure. And then the parameter that we change is gamma, so we change the aspect ratio of the system. So we do this by doing simulations in a periodic domain, and then increasing the box size. And we do very, very big simulations. So we cover the Rayleigh number range from 2 times 10 to the 7 up to 10 to the 9. And then we consider aspect ratio boxes from 1, which is not included in the table here, up to like 128. And like most experiments or simulations so far are in the aspect ratio 0.5 to 1 range as a sort of reference. So the aspect ratios here are very, very large. And we performed these simulations on a big supercomputer in Europe called the Supermark cluster, which we got access to a large-scale grant there, using this AFID code that we discussed there, which is also like as an open source code available. So if you look at these the simulation results from these simulations, we look first at Rayleigh 10 to the 8. So we first keep the Rayleigh number fixed. We look at the temperature field at mid height. So like first, like all these temperature fields are at mid height, and this is for an aspect ratio 2. So like what you can see in this figure is that there's like one region in which the warm fluid is basically going up, which is this red blob over here. Or there's like one region in which this warm, or where the cold fluid is going down, which is this kind of blue blob over here. So we see that there's like basically just one large-scale flow structure in this domain. So we can actually quantify this if you look at some spectra of the flow. So like if we do different spectra, which we do for different aspect ratios here later on, we show the energy spectrum of the flow against the wave number. And then you have to remember that like the smaller wave numbers are indicating the large scale flow structures, and the higher wave numbers are indicating the small scale flow structures. So here we see that this spectrum peaks at the almost the lowest wave number that we have in the box, indicating that a lot of the energy is in the larger scale motions that actually would physically fix into this box. Right? Like this is not something that we want. We actually want to have like multiple of these large scale flow structures in the box in order to make sure that it is not really influenced by the box size. So we made it a little bit bigger. Still, you get sort of the same phenomena that the pileup is here at the biggest scales that would fit in your box. So we can go to an even higher aspect ratio. This is aspect ratio 8, so already quite large. And here you have to remember that it is still a periodic box that we are looking at. So if you look at this flow structure over here, you can actually see that it's basically just still one flow structure, because there's this red band over here. This connects to this red band over here, and there's like one blue band over here. But that with periodicity also connects to here, so there's basically still one large-scale flow structure in this box. So even if we have an aspect ratio 8, we basically get like one large-scale convection roll in the box. So again, this is represented in the spectrum. So we still see that the spectrum is sort of having a peak very close to the larger scales that one would be able to capture in this box. So we can go to some successively higher aspect ratios, and then we see that at this point the spectrum starts to peak at this position here, which is roughly equal to 6 or 7 times the height of the box as for the size of the flow structures. What? K is the horizontal wave numbers, like it's built up of like the horizontal, two horizontal ones, and then like the square root of the horizontal and the spanwise and the streamwise together. Yeah, 2D section, and then like the circular average of that. It may be normalized by the box or by 2 pi or something. That could be. Then I would have to look at the exact definition that we use there. At least this sort of peak in the end sort of corresponds to this roughly like 6 to 7 times the box size. Like that's roughly what you also see here, like the total structure size can be roughly that size, since in the aspect ratio 8 box there's like one flow structure that fits in. So like the total flow structure size that you can have, which is that peak position, is roughly like 6 to 8 times the box size. Or if you would look at a half wavelength, that would be 3 to 4, I should say. So We quantified it a bit more by looking at the integral length scale as function of the aspect ratio for all the different cases that we have available. And this then converges to roughly an integral length scale of 4, having roughly like half that's the full structure size that we see there. So like this is just basically indicating the size of like one red blob over there, if you sort of would want to indicate it with something. So we see that this value converges, indicating the structure sizes in the system whenever we are approaching like roughly aspect ratio 32. We're not exactly sure what happens here at like aspect ratio 16, but it could be this sort of occasion which either the system still is in the case which is like close to an aspect ratio 8, which is happening here for like 2 × 10⁷, or it tends to already switch to what happens for the higher Rayleigh numbers, but it is still not really, just not big enough in order to really comfortably fit it in there. Like it's either in one or the other. Like it's, it seems to be that you really have to have this aspect ratio 32 aspect ratio size in order to really fully converge the structure size. So this is a visualization of like the Rayleigh 10 to the 8 aspect ratio 64 simulation. Just to give you an impression of how this looks like. So this is the temperature field at mid-height, showing all the different red and blue blobs, like indicating the large-scale convection rolls that are formed. So you see that the structure sizes indeed are very, very big. And yeah, we will do some successive zoom-ins, so like the zoom-in is of this section over here. So if you zoom it in 64 times over here, so this is instead of like an aspect ratio 64, this is roughly an aspect ratio 8. You see that this is roughly equivalent to what sort of sizes you have in the box. Like there's like one big upwelling part here, like one big downwelling part over here. And you can do some successive zoom ins up to like a zoom in of like 4,000 times. So this 4,000 times zoom, this is actually an aspect ratio 1. So this case that we see here, this is actually an aspect ratio 1. So like this is what most people would consider nowadays in an experiment or like in many simulations. So you can actually see that tiny crossover here, like this is what people would normally look at. Yeah, sort of showing this zoom in. So the point is that if you look at the physics of the whole system, that actually would want to evolve in much, much bigger structures, which simply cannot form in a more confined box, since the structures don't get the space that they would actually naturally want to evolve to. So this is just showing the spectrum at the boundary layer heights. So like also here, we get this collapse. Like this is not a normalized one. If you would normalize this one, you would see that there's like an additional sort of smaller peak here at somewhat higher wave numbers, indicating the plumes that originate at the boundary layer height, but in this representation it's not really clearly visible. So we can also look at the physics at the boundary layer height. So like this is again the full domain, so we see sort of an imprint of the large-scale convection rolls here as well. So like the large-scale convection rolls, you can actually see if we put the corresponding picture at mid-height and the boundary layer height over here. You can see that there's the blue blobs over here. It's like where the flow is downwelling over here. We see that this is the darker blue areas here in the boundary layer region, or correspondingly the very upwelling parts over here are indicated by this region over here, where the plumes are sort of collecting each other or collecting together in this region over here, causing a sort of warmer temperature in the boundary layer. So like these large-scale patterns are sort of giving a secondary imprint on the boundary layer behavior. Still, the smaller scale plumes that are really responsible for the heat transfer, they don't seem to really change in size. Like the plume sizes remain the same, and the plumes are really what carry like most of the heat transfer. So the heat transfer is actually remarkably insensitive to the structures that are formed on the big part of the domain. And again, we can make some successive zoom-ins, and this is just to show that the resolution from the simulation is actually sufficient in order to capture all the details. So like even when we zoom in 4,000 times here, we see that still this flow solution here is smooth. So in order to look into some more detail of the simulations, we look at first the Nusselt numbers. Like we want to see how these structures actually influence the heat transfer properties of the system. So what we plot in these graphs over here is on the vertical axis, we plot the heat transfer in the system and then normalize with the really to the 1/3 scaling, which we have already discussed several times during this meeting. And then on the horizontal axis, we have the aspect ratio over here. And this is first the results for 10 to the 8. So we see that if we confine the system very a lot, so like this is still only some relative confinement because it's still like periodic, so there's not really a box. Still, when we make the periodic box very small, then the heat transfer really goes down. In the large aspect ratio limit, we converge to one value, as you would expect. It's interesting to see, though, that this this convergence for the heat transfer happens already at an aspect ratio 4, whereas we saw that the structure size itself only really converges at like an aspect ratio 16, already showing that the Nusselt number is rather insensitive to what like the really the big structures in the system are. And there's some peak in the Nusselt number at here at roughly 0.75. And interestingly, this this peak here, so like this is a periodic box, this exactly agrees with the GL prediction for aspect ratio 1 cylinders. Like this is this horizontal dashed line, which is the GL prediction, which was obtained for aspect ratio 1 cylinders, but then in a closed domain, and this is a periodic domain. But still somehow that aspect ratio 1 somehow maximizes the heat transfer. And this is also the prediction that you get for the GL theory. That was like shortly touched upon in the previous lecture. But we see that here the large aspect ratio limit is like a little bit below, like roughly like 5% or so. So we see actually dissimilar behavior also for the different Rayleigh numbers. So like we again see that the GL prediction is exactly recovered at this peak value for the lower Rayleigh number and also for the higher Rayleigh number. And then this plateau region is a little bit different. So you can actually normalize this. So like if we here we normalize the Nusselt number with the Nusselt number at aspect ratio 1 in order to see how strong this effect is, like how much the difference is between the peak value here and the plateau region over here. And this actually becomes less pronounced. So like this, here we see that the higher the Rayleigh number is, the smaller this this drop here is towards the really fully unconfined regime. So we can see the same or somewhat similar characteristics in the Reynolds number characteristics of the flows. Like this is the vertical Reynolds number for the different Rayleigh numbers considered here. And they all have this behavior in which they really drop down whenever the aspect ratio is too small, and they converge to some large aspect ratio limit. Again, this convergence here to large aspect ratio limit is at aspect ratio 4. The peak in this case is at roughly aspect ratio 2, so slightly different than for the Nusselt number. And again, this Nusselt number convergence is at a different aspect ratio than the actual convergence of the structure sizes. And somehow when we normalize this, we get a rather universal curve. Like it doesn't really wash out when we go towards higher Rayleigh numbers. So like from some of the theory that we discussed, you would sort of maybe have the impression like, well, when we increase the Rayleigh number, the flow becomes more and more turbulent. So like some of these large scale structures should actually wash out and this should become less pronounced. But actually we see that this is sort of a universal curve. Like this is something that doesn't seem to disappear when we increase the Rayleigh number. And we also still see that this rather high Rayleigh number of 10 to the 9, or at least that's definitely the biggest we could do for such large aspect ratio boxes. And you see something similar for the horizontal Reynolds number. This actually drops down dramatically when your box size is too small. So like this sort of indicates whenever you increase your box size, you actually get more horizontal motion. So like if you get like a small box, the heat transfer is sort of kept relatively high because there's a lot of heat transfer that is pumped into the system by the plumes that originate from the plates. And then since the plumes cannot go anywhere else, they sort of immediately go to the top and do not create too much of a horizontal wind. Whenever the system becomes very big, this horizontal wind develops more and you get like a stronger horizontal motion in the plumes, which doesn't really contribute too much to the heat transfer, but it does increase sort of the flow speed in the system, which we see over here. It's like this simply saturates only at the point that all the other flow characteristics also converge. And as you can see in this ratio of the vertical and the horizontal Reynolds number, which is very high over here. So like this means that the vertical motion is a lot stronger for the smaller aspect ratios. And then the horizontal and vertical motions are roughly around one. This dashed line here is like when the ratio is exactly one whenever we go to the large aspect ratio limit. And when we take the total flow speed multiplied by the vertical Reynolds number, sort of as a first approximation, like a very simple approximation of like how much heat transfer you would sort of expect, you also see that this quantity sort of peaks around this 0.75 value, which we find the maximum Nusselt number. And this ratio sort of indicates like how much vertical motion do I have in the box and how much motion do I sort of have in general in the box. This is definitely sort of a poor man's approximation, but sort of gives you an impression of what's roughly happening. I think this is already like one of the last slides I was planning to show. Like this is sort of a characterization of like how much difference does this actually make on several of the flow characteristics that that we can observe in this box. So we look at some turbulence statistics that some of them have also been discussed in the course, but this is the standard deviation of the temperature. This is the skewness of the temperature, and this is the kurtosis or flatness of the temperature. And then as function of height, so like the zero is the plate, and this is the mid height, and then the data are averaged for like the top and the bottom part of the domain, since there's like symmetry around the mid plane in the simulations. And then there's like three simulations that are really in confined boxes, which are the black, the red, and the blue, which are these curves here that really deviate from the larger aspect ratio limits, which are 8 to 64, which are sort of all clustered in a very different characteristic statistics that we show over here. So specifically, we see that in the more confined box, the kurtosis of the temperature is a lot higher than we see in the unconfined box. Like in the unconfined box, we have something that is like close to kurtosis flatness of like roughly 3.5 or something, whereas like a Gaussian distribution would have 3. So like the main message from this is also that if you really have like the unconfined system, also all the turbulent characteristics of this flow are very different, but then the heat transfer is rather insensitive, since that seems to be like a phenomenon that is originated from the boundary layer. Like the plumes carry the heat away from the plate, and like how quickly the plumes transfer the heat into the bulk domain, that is an important characteristic for how much heat transfer you get in the end in the system. So the flow structures change, but the heat transfer doesn't change as much as you would maybe think it to be based on like how big of a change you see in the flow structure. So the main message is that we have observed like very, very large superstructures in Rayleigh-Benard convection, like roughly like 6 to 7 times the height of the system, so like much bigger than we previously anticipated, and also much bigger than almost all the simulations and experiments done before. And we showed that this is a very strong dependence on like the turbulence statistics that we obtain in the flow structure sizes and like dynamics that you would obtain in such a system. So I would also take the opportunity to make some advertisement for the international conference on Rayleigh-Benard convection that we will organize next year in May in the University of Twente. So like the site for this conference is now up, so you can find it through the website of our group. And like registration for this will be open in a few months. Like it's not open yet, but you can already take a look at the dates and see whether you would be able to visit. And like Professor Verma is also one of the invited speakers at that conference. So with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I will take any questions that you may have. So like this is also a video of like one of these simulations showing the dynamical behavior of these large-scale structures.
It's quite remarkable that fine-scale details have been shown in this Rayleigh-Benard convection, thanks to the group also, in terms of enlightening us on Rayleigh-Benard convection. Any questions?
Richard, gamma equal to 4 seems to be the turning point, you know, the crossover.
Yeah, so
why is it so?
Like, there are somehow two turning points. If you look in all the statistical quantities, which are sort of the global quantities, which are like Reynolds number, Nusselt number, and so on, you would really guess that like gamma is 4 is like really your turnover point. So like all these statistical quantities, they really converge perfectly to like the large aspect ratio limit at aspect ratio is 4. If we determine the aspect ratio of all the flow structures, especially in the middle of the domain, then we somehow get that the structure sizes is bigger than that. And the structure sizes are really only converged whenever that aspect ratio is 32. The structure sizes itself are like 6 to 8, as said. So like apparently, whenever you have like an aspect ratio 4, the structure sizes are boxes big enough that the structure that is formed is quite close to what you would get in the in the sort of ultimate regime there, like the really large aspect ratio regime, it's very close, and therefore you get similar statistics. But it is peculiar to observe that the statistics are fully converged at aspect ratio 4, but the flow structure size is not. So that's a peculiar observation. We don't know exactly why that is. Like the heat transfer, we kind of have an idea, but why the Reynolds number is also exactly converged, even though the flow structure is still changing, we don't exactly know why that is. It's really observational.
Any other questions?
You normalize your Reynolds number using 1/3, relate to the 1/3. So is it 1/3 scaling or you are assuming in Reynolds number? Yes. Is it 1/2 or?
Like here it must be like close to 1/3 because the lines are like roughly equal. Like it's not exactly 1/3, otherwise the lines would overlap. So this clearly it's slightly different, but it seems to be relatively close. Mm-hmm. It's, I did not determine what this scaling is, so like then I would have to determine this.
Okay.
Like if it would be 1/3, then the lines would overlap. So it is clearly not exactly 1/3, but I'm not sure exactly what it is.
Okay.
Any other questions?
For the large aspect ratio plots that you showed, it looks more homogeneous than compared to the small aspect ratios. So if we let's say when you zoomed in, the plots were much less homogeneous, and I guess there might be some relation to that with the statistics that you showed.
Like one very pronounced difference is the ratio of the horizontal and vertical velocities, which is like roughly 1 in the large aspect ratio limits, but it's definitely quite high for lower aspect ratio cells. Like this, in some sense, also has to or can have its impact on like how the flow structures look like. It's somewhat difficult to somehow see that just from a visualization sometimes, but it's clear that here we have like large aspect ratio limits, horizontal and vertical velocities are roughly the same size.
Yeah.
But this is not the case for the smaller aspect ratio. So clearly some of the terminal statistics are different in that small aspect ratio regime. So like this.
Could that be linked to the you showed that the skewness and kurtosis, they were like it was close to 4 for the large aspect ratio box. There's a very pronounced difference between the 1, 2, 3 and 16, 32. So
like this would have a this would have a pronounced difference on like how these structures would look like. Yeah.
Yes.
Although it is always difficult to see from really a visualization how how it exactly materializes in like a visualization, but clearly the statistics are quite different.
Okay, if no questions, let us thank the speaker.